Baptist Church. We're glad that you guys are all here with us to worship today. I ask that if you're a guest, if you're a new person here, if you would just grab one of the Connect cards, you'll find those located in the back of the pew that's in front of you, and just fill that out. And for anybody else, if you have any prayer requests, just get the Connect card, and on the back of it, write a specific prayer request, and your elders will take that in and reach out to you and pray for you. And when you get a chance, just put it at the offering box here located by the exit. Today's call to worship is coming from Psalm 8. Psalm 8 reads, O Lord our God, how majestic is your name in all of the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him? And what is the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all of the earth. Pray with me. Father, everywhere that we look, we see your glory. We see the work of your fingers, even in creation, as it cries out how majestic you are. And God, and to think that you would make man, you would make us in your image, let alone to have the Son of Man go lower than the heavenly beings. So, Father, let us see Jesus Christ lifted high up today. Let us see how glorious he is. Let us look to him who you have crowned Lord of all and the King of Kings. In his name we pray today. Amen.
Amen. Why don't you stand as we begin our time of worship together this morning. We believe this morning, church. Let's give him praise. Amen.
alone. My hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid.
Limitations this morning, chapter 3, verses 21 through 24. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will have hope in him.
thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all
together this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, the day that you have made. As we celebrate the gift of our country this weekend and the freedoms provided by citizenship, we recognize that it's you that have blessed us. You established nations. You have provided us with freedom to meet and together in fellowship this morning. Fellowship in a common bond through your Holy Spirit. Lord, thank you for our great republic and the people living in this land. And Lord, we need your help. We need your hope. People passionately quarrel these days, especially over the debate of abortion, arguing to persuade human decision in courts and in government. Lord, I pray that we would root our hope in you, and not in any human or institution. I pray that you would hold back the evil that would seek to destroy the life of an unborn baby. Lord, I know that for For many people, the debate is not that simple. I pray for your softening of hearts on both sides of the argument, that there would truly be a value for life, that there would be no haughtiness or gloating or vengeful response from those who celebrate. And Lord, in the same way, no lashing out for those who grieve. Father, this morning I pray your words from Romans chapter 12 over our congregation this morning. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil and hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Repay no one evil for evil. And then, Lord, as you remind us as well, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Father, as we turn our hearts to sit under the teaching of your word, open our ears that we might hear. In Christ's name, amen.
If you're able, stand with us as we sing another song before Pastor Thomas comes up this morning.
Cast my mind to Calvary. Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in
up together, church will praise the name.
Jesus' face.
Lord our God. Yes, church, give him praise this morning. Amen. Have a seat if you would.
God. Let's go ahead and grab our Bibles and let's meet in Matthew chapter 15. It's always a joy to hear everyone worship. Matthew 15, verses 29 through 39. Okay, so before we read the text, I kind of want to set the scene for us this morning. So for about a year and a half, Jesus has been ministering in Galilee. He has been serving the northern part of Palestine. He's been serving the Jewish people there. So he's been doing these miracles, these signs, these wonders. He's been teaching about the kingdom of God. So after a year and a half, though, it was very clear that there's beginning to be some sort of mounting resistance against Jesus. A resistance that will eventually lead to this full-blown rejection. So in a sense, the pressure was on. Now, if you're familiar with your history, then you know about Herod Antipas. Herod Antipas was the king that was given the assignment of keeping the political peace between the Jews and the Jewish people in Rome. Also, Herod was paranoid as all get out. I mean, he was always thinking that someone was out to get him. That's one of the reasons why back in chapter 14, he did not hesitate to have John the Baptist executed. And now, there's this itinerant preacher, Jesus, who people are following because of this tremendous power. Herod would later on come to think that this is John the Baptist incarnate. So in a sense, you can feel the tension in the background just building. And then, there's also the hatred from the scribes and the Pharisees, the religious leaders of the day. They begin to hate Jesus because of Jesus' authority and his willingness to correct these elites. That's the beginning of chapter 15. So again, there's more pressure in the background. There's more tension. And then to that, you add the fact that these Jewish crowds that were wanting to make Jesus king. So John tells us that after the feeding of the 5,000, these crowds were like, hey, you know what? I like this guy. Let's go ahead and make him king. And this wasn't because of a regenerate heart, but it was because of a hatred towards their current leadership. And Jesus tells the crowds to leave. He tells the disciples to get on the boat. So you can feel it, the resistance of the people, the reality of Jesus' message, the shallowness of the false disciples, the pressure of the scribes and the Pharisees, the paranoia of Herod. It all sets the scene for us as we see this amazing contrast between the spiritual pride of the Jews and the genuine hunger and humility of the Gentiles. One author put it this way. He said, what Jesus could not find among his own people, Jesus found among strangers. And so far, only twice in the book of Matthew have we heard Jesus say, you have great faith. And both times it was to a Gentile. So he moves from his ministry in Galilee and he goes into Gentile territory. Last week we saw the story of a Gentile woman. And now we'll see Jesus' encounter with thousands of Gentiles. So that's Matthew chapter 15, verses 29 through 39. This is the most important thing that I will say today. This is the word of the Lord. Beginning with verse 29. And Jesus went on from there, and he walked beside the Sea of Galilee, and he went up a mountain and sat down there. And great crowds came to him, bringing with them the lame, the blind, the crippled, the mute, and many others. And they put him at his feet, and he healed them. So that the crowds, they wondered when they saw the mute speaking and the crippled healthy and the lame walking and the blind seeing. And they glorified the God of Israel. Verse 32. Then Jesus called to his disciples and said to them, I have compassion on the crowd because they have been with me now for 3 days and they have nothing to eat. And I am unwilling to send them away hungry lest they faint away. And the disciples said to them, where are we to get enough bread in such a desolate place to feed such a crowd? And Jesus said to them, how many loaves do you have? And they said, 7 and a few small fish. And directing the crowd to sit down on the ground, he took the 7 loaves and the fish, and having given thanks, he broke them and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. And they all ate, and they were satisfied. And they took up 7 baskets full of broken pieces left over. Verse 38. And those who ate were 4,000 men besides women and children. And after sending away the crowds, he got into the boat and went to the region of Magadan. That is our text. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Pray with me. Father, we come before you this morning asking for your help. Help us, Lord, to understand this text. Help me to teach this text. Make much of your word and make little of me, Father. God, we ask that the Spirit of God would use the word of God to reveal the amazing Son of God. And we ask this in his name. Amen. All right, so in this passage, we see Jesus' encounter with many Gentiles. He heals many of them, and then he feeds 4,000 of them. So we're talking maybe 12 to 15,000 people. Now, you're probably thinking, if you've been with us the past few weeks, you're probably thinking, didn't Matthew already preach about the story? He brought the little Lunchable thing up, and didn't he already preach about this? Well, we haven't. We haven't covered the story. The feeding of the 5,000 is in chapter 14, and the feeding of the 4,000 is in chapter 15. So some people, they forget that there's 2 major feedings in the Gospels. These are 2 stories that happen at 2 different times and at 2 different places. They're separated by a couple of weeks, if not a couple of months. So going from Galilee to Tyre and then Sidon and then down the east side of the sea to the Decapolis, that would have taken a while. If you have a study Bible, I'm sure it provides you a little picture there with a map. Also, the feeding of the 5,000 had a Jewish audience, whereas the feeding of the 4,000 has a strictly Gentile audience. So they're 2 different stories. But even then, they do have a lot of similarities. They each include fish, bread. They're in a desolate place. There's the disciples. There's many leftovers. And there's a large crowd. But most importantly, they both give us this beautiful picture of what Jesus is like. So just flip back to chapter 14. Look at chapter 14. 14, verse 14. It says this. And when he, Jesus, went ashore and he saw a great crowd, this is the Jewish people, he had compassion on them and he healed their sick. And now flip back to chapter 15, verse 32. Then Jesus called his disciples to him and said, this is Jesus speaking, I have compassion on the crowd, these Gentiles, because they have been with me now for 3 days and they have nothing to eat. See the common denominator? Compassion. Jesus' compassion is the main thrust for today's text and the main theme of our section. It's compassion. So what is compassion? The word coming from the Latin, it means to suffer with. And in the English, it goes a little bit deeper than that. The English dictionary would describe compassion as a feeling of deep sympathy and sorrow accompanied by a strong desire to alleviate the pain and to remove its cause. So it's not only to suffer with someone or to feel their pain, but to have this strong desire to see its cause permanently eliminated. So in other words, how I like to put it, to feel for a person and to do something about it. And I think that's the exact definition of what was in Jesus' heart, who when looking upon people in need, he identifies with that need. He felt sympathy, he felt sorrow for that need, and he had a strong desire to see its cause removed. Now, if we learn anything at all about God, you learn in the scriptures that he is a God of great compassion. He suffers with his people. He feels their pain. And more than that, he seeks to alleviate the cause. That's exactly why he redeems us. That's exactly why he heals us and comforts us and extends grace and mercy and loving kindness in order to reach man in their need and to deliver them from it. We read Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22 says, because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. So in other words, if we got what we deserved, we would be consumed. But it's his compassion towards us that restricts that, and that in return it extends mercy. Verse 23 says, these mercies are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. God is a God of great compassion. We see that over and over again in God's dealings with Israel in the Old Testament. Just sit down and read Exodus chapter 33 or 2 Kings 13 or 2 Chronicles 36. And there's many other passages that you can turn to where you hear God say something like, I have compassion on you and I am withholding my judgment. I am withholding the trouble that could come upon you because of my compassion. Not because of anything that it's in you, not because of anything that you did, but simply because of my grace, because of my mercy, because of my compassion towards you. God is a God of great compassion. In Romans chapter 9, we know this. What did God say? It says, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. Now, if God is a God of compassion, a God who cares, a God who cares about every small hurt or every small need in every life, if that's the kind of God that God is, then we would expect Jesus to be compassionate, should we not? Yes. And so when we come to Matthew chapter 15, verse 32, and when we are not at all surprised that Jesus says, I have compassion. We've heard him say it in chapter 14. We heard him say it back in chapter 9. Chapter 9, 36 says that Jesus, he looked at the multitude, and it says that he was moved with compassion because they were scattered as sheep without a shepherd. So our God is a God of compassion. It's a compassionate God. And Christ, God in the flesh, is equally as compassionate. And we see that in our text. This is the compassionate Jesus who saw a crowd of sinners, of Gentiles at that, showing us that his compassion, it has no boundaries. And what did he do? Did he run away? Did he dismiss them? Did he ignore them? No. Look at verse 30. And great crowds came to him, bringing with them the lame, the blind, the crippled, the mute, and many others. And they put them at his feet, and he healed them. So that the crowd wondered when they saw the mute speaking, and the crippled healthy, and the lame walking, and the blind seeing. So what did he do? He stayed with them. Verse 32 says that he stayed with them for 3 days. So Jesus went up the mountain. He sat down. This is a posture of a teaching posture of a rabbi. So he taught them. He prayed with them. He talked with them. He spent time with them. And Gentiles are bringing other people to him, bringing the lame, the blind, the crippled, and many, many more. People that are paralyzed, people that can't see, people that can't talk. The word crippled here, in the Greek, it's the word koulos. So this is the same word that we found in Matthew chapter 18, verse 8, where Jesus talks about how it's better for you to pluck your eye than to offend God. So it's a unique picture that we have here. It's a picture of something being severed or something being removed, kind of like a limb. But even then, Jesus healed those people. So if they didn't have an arm, he gave them an arm. If they didn't have a leg, he gave them a leg. If they were missing an ear, he gave them an ear. If they had lost a finger, he gave them a finger. If they couldn't speak, he made them speak. If they were blind, he made them see. He healed all of them. And the text just says that they brought these people to his feet. Now, you have to picture this. Can you imagine the chaos of this? Remember, this is taking place in the Decapolis. So Decapolis, it's Deca, meaning 10, Polis, meaning city. So in the area of the 10 cities, so the outskirts of these 10 cities. And I bet you there was people leaving them and coming out in a desperate mode, knowing that Jesus could heal, hoping, swarming Jesus, hoping that he would heal them. And the text says, he healed them. In the beginning of verse 31, it says that the crowd, they wondered at this, meaning that they marveled at this. They were struck in absolute awe at this scene. They had no mere human explanation of what in the world is happening. Their brains couldn't fathom what just happened. They couldn't connect the dots because this is impossible. This is beyond imagination. This is incredible. And you see the result of this? Look at verse 31. And they glorified the God of Israel. The Jews were skeptical. Their vision was blurred by spiritual pride and by tradition, just like it is in today's day. And you contrast that with the Gentiles who are over here glorifying the God of Israel. I mean, what a beautiful picture, what a beautiful trailer, a beautiful appetizer of what is to come. A day when people will be whole, where people will be complete, people will be new, fully restored, and worshiping the one true God. And Jesus' compassion, it doesn't just end at a healing. He teaches them, he heals them, he spends time with them. And like any good Baptist, he feeds them. Put your eyes on verse 37. Look at 37. And they all ate and were satisfied. And they took up 7 baskets full of broken pieces left over. And those who ate were 4,000 men besides women and children. So there's one thing that's unique about Jesus and the way that he ended each phase of ministry with a feeding. So he ended the ministry in Galilee with the feeding of the 5,000. He ended the ministry in the Gentile area with the feeding of the 4,000. And we know that he ended his Judean ministry with a feeding in the upper room. This is before his death. Simple. The Lord always keeps his people fed. He moves towards people. He meets their needs. He teaches them. He spends time with them. He feeds them. He's a compassionate God. Jesus is a God of great compassion. And more so than any other emotion, than any other disposition, compassion is mostly used to characterize Jesus, to describe what he is like. Compassion is the motivation of so much of what Jesus does. He meets the needs of his people. Now, I want you to follow my argument, okay? We know this verse. Romans 8:29. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. So this means that if you sit here this morning and you are a Christian, then one of the reasons for your election is that you would be conformed to the image of Christ, that you would be more like Christ. Therefore, if compassion so characterized Christ, then surely it characterizes us, should it not? Yes? Francis Schaeffer, he puts it this way when he talks about this passage. He says, biblical orthodoxy without compassion is surely one of the ugliest things in the world. I'll say it again. Biblical orthodoxy without compassion is surely one of the ugliest things in the world. And I agree. Now, he's not saying that biblical orthodoxy is wrong. No, we know that biblical orthodoxy is important. It is paramount. If we only have compassion without biblical orthodoxy, then we are no different than any other social movement in today's day. That's not the case. However, though, without compassion, all catechisms, all creeds, all systematic theologies that we love so much, all of them, they become hideous without compassion. Now, don't misunderstand me. It's not an either or, okay? It's not an either or. It's a both and. Biblical orthodoxy and compassion, they go perfectly together. In fact, the Bible makes it crystal clear that evidence of a legitimate faith is compassion towards brothers and sisters. 1 John brings this up, so does James. James chapter 2, verse 15. If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warm and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? Verse 17. So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, it is dead. You see, it's a both and. We want to be people of compassion that are constantly being conformed, sanctified into the image of Christ. But how do we do that? How do we become more Christ-like in our compassion towards others? How do we fulfill that personally in ourselves and in our families? Also, how do we fulfill that corporately as a local gathered body of believers? And these are questions that we all need to be wrestling with. How do we, as Olivet Baptist Church, ensure that we are a compassionate body of believers? I think our text answers that question. And just to put it, I'm trying to work on this applicational one-liner, to put it in a simple, catchy way, I give you one point for today. See the need, meet the need. See the need, meet the need. If our definition of compassion is a feeling of deep sympathy and sorrow accompanied by a strong desire to alleviate the pain or to remove its cause, or how I put it, to feel for a person and to do something about it, if that is compassion, then I believe that our application of see the need, meet the need is fitting. And we can do that in two different ways. First and foremost, we know that there's a need in this world. There's a deep spiritual need. Everybody here, everybody everywhere is in need of a Savior. We have all sinned against a holy and righteous God. We have a debt that needs to be paid, sin that needs to go punished, regardless of who you are, whether you're a Jew or a Gentile, you need a Savior. So while we here don't save anyone, we always point to the one who can save anyone. We point people to Jesus. We individually and corporately, we open our mouths and we tell people of their sin and their rebellion against a holy God, and we make it clear that they cannot save themselves. But we also make it clear that Christ can. that where we failed, Christ succeeded. That where we sinned, he was sinless. And that where we deserve punishment for our sins, Jesus gave us grace by substituting himself on the cross. And he rose from the dead, commanding all people everywhere to repent and to believe. This is our gospel. This is our message. You see, Jesus just didn't come to the Gentiles and the Decapolis because he wanted people to listen to him. No, he didn't just come to show off his food-making power. No, he came because he saw a group outside of the house of Israel and he had compassion on them. So he moved towards them. He provided them with their biggest need, himself. And they glorified the God of Israel. And church, there is a need in our world. There's a need in our homes. There's a need in our workplaces. There's a need in our schools. There's our need. There's a need in our co-ops. There's a need to get the gospel right and to get the gospel out. That's the need here. So those of you who have been coming to Reaching Indian Hills, man, you've noticed this. You have seen this. You notice that there's a need for the gospel. There's a deep spiritual need. And, so not second, but and, there's also a physical need. We live in a physical world. A world that has been affected by the fall. A world where disease, pain, confusion, hurt, and death are all at work. A world where people are homeless. A world where the young die. A world where bellies rumble. A world where adoptions are needed. A world filled with people made in the image of God who are in need. And so here's my plea for us today. I'm calling us to action. Paul would say to be zealous for good works. And here's what I mean. God has uniquely gifted every single one of you in a specific way. He has made you, he has wired you a certain way, he has impressed a need or a people or a ministry in your heart, and the Holy Spirit has been pushing you towards it, has been tugging at you, nudging at you towards it. The Holy Spirit has given you these spiritual gifts to be used for his glory and for our good, for the advancement of the kingdom. So today, I simply call on us as a body of believers to see a need and to meet the need. Don't see a need and then think that somebody else is going to handle that. You do it. You do it. Don't see a need and then complain and grumble about how nobody is meeting that need. You meet the need. You take the initiative. You pray. You ponder. You plan. God has equipped you for every good work. I mean, Jesus has invited us to play a role in this mission, to play a part in this. This is a privilege that we all have. Okay, Thomas, but how can I meet people's needs when I have so little? Well, aren't you amazed at what Jesus can do with some bread and a few small pieces of fish? Okay, Thomas, but what does that look like? That's a really good question. Just look around. Look to people who look nothing like you, and look to people who look like you. Ask yourselves, where is the need? Meet the need. Look at verse 36. It says, he, Jesus, took the 7 loaves and the fish, and having given thanks, he broke them and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds, and they all ate, and they were satisfied. And there's a truth here. The truth is that Jesus invites us all to play a part. He doesn't need us. He could have done this by himself. But he chooses for his disciples to be the hands and feet of meeting people's needs. And this is a privilege that we as followers of Christ have. And I'll end with just reiterating this, okay? I am not saying meet needs for need's sake. I am saying that our motives behind this, it matters. God is not just after your good deeds. He wants our deeds to flow from grace, to flow from a heart of compassion, a heart that has been washed by his own compassion. That's what he wants. And if we as Christians, if we lack compassion, then it's in all likelihood that we all have Christian amnesia, a memory problem. Just like the disciples here in this text, they already forgot what Christ has done. They forgot about the feeding of the 5,000 in chapter 14. And in the same way, we have the tendency of forgetting what God has done through Christ. We are forgetting the gospel. We are forgetting the time when we were in the most need. And my hope today, as we move forward, is that our memory of the image of God in others and our own neediness before a holy God, that that might fan into flame this Christ-like compassion within our church, in our hearts, and towards others. Pray with me. Father, you are a God of compassion, a God who doesn't look from a distance, a God who doesn't yell from the stands. You're a God who doesn't turn a blind eye to the needs of his people. Rather, Father, you move towards us. You saw us in need and you came to our rescue. You have a hands-on approach to our salvation and in our sanctification. Jesus, you humbled yourself even to the point of death, even death on a cross. And Spirit, we would ask that you would help us, make us more like Jesus today, more than ever before. Spirit, we ask that you would conform us to his image. And we ask this for the glory of the Father, in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Why don't you stand with us as we sing a closing song this morning?
Throne, the earth you formed was not your home. A love like this the world had never known. A crown of thorns.
Some quick announcements for us. So this week there's going to be no Reaching Indian Hills. We will pick things back up the following week, and then July 6th, this Wednesday, it's our next fellowship night. So we're going to meet at Sycamore Park at 6:30. The church will provide popsicles, but bring a picnic dinner if you'd like, and some lawn chairs and just outdoor games. On July 23rd, there is a daddy-daughter dance. If you are on the email, you can go on there and sign up for that. And be sure to sign up for discipleship groups this fall. That's on the email as well. A lot of this is on the email. Last thing. At the end of our gathering, Matthew wanted to take the entire month of July just to remind us all of the Value Them Both Amendment, so the vote that's coming up in August 2nd. So we just want to remind you of this vote and tell you how important it is for you to register ASAP and to vote. Specifically to vote on the side of life. We believe in a God of life, and our church partners with this organization and with Embrace, so we want to continue to support them even by voting, especially now in light of the overturning of Roe v. Wade. I mean, praise God for that. Praise God. Last thing, Brother Matt, you have something to share?
I just wanted to extend an invite to my church family here. You guys walked with us through one of the darkest times of our life, with Cade being in the hospital for several days, quite a few months ago. And we have some really good friends of ours. Their daughter, her name is Promise. She is 2 years old, and she is currently at KU Med dealing with upper respiratory issues, and she's intubated. A lot of similarities with what we went through. And so we know how they feel, and so we decided that we're going to hold a night of prayer for Promise this Friday, July 8th at 7 p.m. at Glen Park Christian Church. Our church agreed to host it here, but his home church where they attend are able to host, so we're going to do it at Glen Park Christian Church this Friday, July 8th at 7 p.m., and kind of the agenda is to come together and gather and worship and pray. We're going to have some prayer points that I'm going to send out. If you guys are on Facebook, I'm going to send out those prayer points to our Olivet family page. So if you're not able to attend, we just ask that you guys labor in with us and ask God to, heal this little girl that's in the hospital and wrap our arms around this family. And if you need a reminder, I printed out some of these flyers and put out front here, but would love if you guys would come and pray with us and worship with us.
Yeah, for sure. We're a little early. I'll leave us with the benediction from 2 Timothy 3:16, verses 16 through 17. It says, "All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work." We have been equipped with God's word. I love you all. We are dismissed.